Good evening, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd. I hope you had a blessed and wonderful day today. I have a question. Have you ever seen someone, or do you know individuals whom you view as not living right according to the Word of God, not living for God and doing for God? Have you ever observed them just prospering in one way after the other, be it through their job, houses, cars, money, so forth and so on? Do you sit back and try and figure out why are they being blessed? Why are they succeeding? Why are all these good things happening to them as I struggle and toil through the daily trials of life? Well, let me say this. Be very careful when you go down that road. Be careful not to become envious and jealous and questioning of the Most High as to why. There is a purpose that God allows for these things to happen. We just have to do what we're supposed to do in being obedient. God can allow and bless the wicked as well as the righteous for His purposes. Remember, all will be done in the end to glorify His name. But I'm going to give you some education according to the Word to help you understand, so that you will see according to the Word of the Most High, that we needn't have any concerns about that, and we should even spend any energy in trying to figure it out, because God has it all in control. So with that being said, let's find out more about the prosperity of the wicked. Now, because we see an unrighteous or quote-unquote wicked person prosper, even in their sinful condition, many of them oftentimes become comfortable in believing that they are okay in their sin. Many of them fail to realize that they have a responsibility and duty to God and to their fellow man to do His will with these blessings, the ones that God has allowed to fall upon them. See, God allows blessings to fall upon whomever He will allow them to fall upon for His purposes. He allows those to receive them an opportunity to do what is right, required by His word. Luke 12:43 reads like this. Blessed is a servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find doing His will, people. And that servant which knew his Lord's will, and that servant which knew his Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. Now, some can take that, and many will take that at this point and say, but I didn't know. I had all these blessings and received all these things, but I thought they were for me. I didn't know what the Lord's will was. But the Word of God continues on in verse 48 and says this. But he that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more. Meaning that those who receive more is required of them than those who didn't receive as much. So don't be misled, people. None of us will have an excuse for not doing His will, because the truth is out there, and it has been out there for a long time, because we are now in the last days. So the truth has been out there for many days. Romans 1, starting with verse 21, says this. Because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. And worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator. People spend a lot of time worshiping the creation and not the Creator. But God addresses it all, people. So those who are relying on ignorance as an excuse have no excuse and will not have an excuse. When we go home and watch television and do all sorts of things while our Bible sits on a desk or a nightstand and collects dust for 6 days until we touch it again, we will have no excuse to claim to avoid the stripes of affliction and pain that fall upon us. So let's talk about the prospering wicked or unrighteous in our sight and what we should take from this according to the Word of God. Because too many of us spend too much of God's valuable time trying to figure out why this and why that when it comes to why some receive blessings and prosperity when we don't believe that they should be, especially when so many like ourselves, like I said, are struggling. But see, the struggle is what we make it. Job 21 and verse 7 addresses the question this way. It says, "Wherefore do the wicked live, become old, yea, are mighty in power or in wealth?" Job proves against his adversaries that God doesn't always immediately punish the wicked, but oftentimes allows them long life and prosperity, showing us that we must not judge God, just or unjust, by the things that appear before our eyes. Our eyes and our own mind can be the biggest deception, folks. We must not pay that much attention to it to where we allow ourselves to be deceived. Verse 8, "Their seed is established in their sight with them, and their offspring before their eyes. Their houses are safe from fear, neither is the rod of God upon them." Verse 10, "Their bull gendereth and faileth not, their cow calveth and casteth not her calf. They send forth their little ones like a flock, and their children dance. They take the timbrel and harp and rejoice at the sound of the organ. They spend their days in wealth and in a moment go down to the grave." We witness the unrighteous prosper and succeed in so many ways in their life despite who or what they are. We see this all the time. They have nice, safe homes, living in better neighborhoods than most of us. Their children are happy and blessed with wanting nothing, and their household is rejoicing at every turn. They may have a long, happy life, spending their days in wealth and success, and then suddenly die without suffering from a disease or illness. They may just die in their sleep or what have you. And for us, it may be the opposite. Poverty or struggling in this world, a shortened life, and we may suffer a long road to death by illness or disease. God is showing us something important here, people, about what we witness with our eyes. We have to not ask the question, why does God allow good things to happen to bad people or bad things to happen to good people? He has a plan, and in the end, it will glorify His name and be what's best for His true faithful. We must not let our carnal mind and these carnal eyes mislead us. Ecclesiastes 12:14 says, "For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." And in Romans 2:16, He tells us that He will do this by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. So you should not care about those unrighteous around you prospering. They will pay for what they've done, but maybe not now in our sight, but they will later, unless they have a true conversion and turn their lives over to the Most High. God admonishes us by his own word in Psalms 37:1, saying this, "Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity." But nonetheless, so many people do this. So here's the question. Are you going to let them have a negative influence on your salvation through your envy, covetousness, and jealousy? You need to ask yourself that question, and you need to say, no, I'm not going to care about what they're doing. I'm going to worry about what I'm doing. The Lord is putting us in situations to be proven worthy people, and many of us are still failing the same trials over and over again. But don't worry. He's going to bring us right back to it for another go around until we prevail. And keep in mind that each time we have to repeat a trial, it would be more difficult than the time before to overcome it or conquer it because we failed the last time. If we can't pass these small trials now, people, what are we going to do when the truly tumultuous times come? What are we going to do? We're not going to make it. Remember Pharaoh? Every time that God displayed his power, taking Pharaoh back time and time again to the same trial, which was submission, which he kept failing, it became more and more difficult for him to pass the trial each successive time because his heart became more and more hardened at each trial. And finally, to a point, his heart was totally hardened, meaning that God turned him over to himself. Remember, like I said, God didn't literally harden Pharaoh's heart himself. Pharaoh did it by refusing to acknowledge the Almighty, becoming more and more stubborn and rebellious at each powerful display of God. God simply, by his display, revealed Pharaoh's true character, and ours is displayed in times of trial also. We can surrender to him and trust him, or be stubborn, angry, murmuring, complaining, faithless, wanting, etc., etc. Psalm 73:3 says this, "For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked." To do this in spite of what God's word says is a trap, people, and it's set up by the enemy, and it will lead us into the sin that it is. God's word says not to do it. When we view the wicked in their prosperity with our carnal eyes and process what we see with our carnal mind, we're setting ourselves up for sin. We must view all that we hear and see spiritually according to the word of God so that we avoid sin in our hearts. The word tells us in Proverbs 13 verses 21 and 22 that evil pursueth sinners, but to the righteous good shall be repaid. A good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. The wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. So don't deceive yourselves, people, in what you think you see at the hands of the wicked. And it means this. Verse 16. "Though he heap up silver as the dust," talking about the wicked, "and prepare raiment as the clay, he may prepare it, but the just shall put it on, and the innocent shall divide the silver." Job 27:16-17. In even plainer terms, all these gains and abundance that have been misused and misappropriated by so many that were meant to be used to God's glory by the unrighteous are all being collected up for the righteous when it's all said and done. We all understand that generally those who are prosperous in the world tend to be those who are in rule in some form or another. And these are typically leaders of business, governments, even in the church, or any entity that generally is placed in power above you and I. The problem is, though, that there tends to be a lot of corruption and wickedness that goes hand in hand with so much prosperity, even in the churches. So it's no wonder that people have a difficult time humbly accepting the idea of seeing unrighteousness continue to prosper, especially as they see themselves do what is right and still struggle. But as I said, God is always in control, and if we are faithful unto death, if necessary, it will work out for us. Remember, He will provide all our needs. Everything else is extra. Proverbs 29 and verse 2 says, When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn. The people mourn inside when the wicked are in rule because it's a trial for the poor, especially for those with an understanding, because they recognize the wicked by their doings. And the word tells us in Proverbs 28 that he that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. He that giveth unto the poor shall not lack, but he that hideth his eyes shall have many a curse. When the wicked rise, men hide themselves, but when they perish, the righteous increase. So understand that people we view as not doing right, being allowed to prosper, are in their own trial with God. Ecclesiastes 2:26 reads, "For God giveth to man that is good in his sight wisdom and knowledge and joy, but to the sinner he giveth travail, to gather and to heap up, that he may give to him that is good before God. This also is vanity and vexation of spirit." Some of these people are in a battle for their salvation, while some of us are spending time in sin being jealous and envious because we can't understand why they are being blessed with prosperity. But keep in mind, the enemy may be doing the blessing to rob them of their soul and drag you into the web of sin at the same time. Remember, God says, "Be not envious against evil men, neither desire to be with them." Proverbs 24:4. When God allows the wicked to prosper, it can seem to us that He favors their doings over ours. So for us to question what we see because we lack the understanding is to question God. Psalms 37:7 says, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil." Jealousy, envy, coveting, and even murmuring and gossiping about why and how so-and-so has acquired X, Y, and Z is sin, people. God says, "For evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth." That was verse 9 in Psalms 37. So the word told us to not become an evildoer with the prosperous wicked by our jealousies and envyings. Be very careful when you find yourself questioning the Most High, people. He gives us all we need in His Word if only we study it. If we study to show ourselves approved unto God, 2 Timothy 2:15, the Holy Spirit will be able to give us the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding that we need, just like He did for Christ. Isaiah 11 reads in verses 2 through 5, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove things the hearing of his ears." Don't let these physical attributes that we have deceive us, people. If some of us and the wicked don't overcome self and do right by God, especially those in their prosperity which belongs to God, they will in the end pay. Think about how difficult it is for people to take the blessings that they have received from God directly or through the workings of the adversary, take them and do what God would have them do with them. For instance, You can't even get most professed believers to give 10% tithe offering in church. For instance, take those who make, say, $500 a week. I'm willing to safely say that those professed believers who attend worship, at least half don't drop 10% or $50 into the offering plate every week. Too many of us would justify giving up $50 a week to the church. And that's the problem. Too many of us are thinking about man and forget that we are giving this to God because it is all His. God says to give your tithe, not to be concerned about where it goes. He'll deal with the corrupt. We need to focus on our obedience to God to increase our blessings. There is no scriptural link, people. There is no scriptural link between earthly success and the following of the Most High. Paul says that, "But my God shall supply all your need according to His riches in His glory by Christ Jesus." Philippians 4:19. He says He will provide all we need and not all we want. All that we want may not be good for us, and it won't make us more obedient to God. If anything, as many of you know, with spoiled children, we can create selfish, entitled, whiny, ungrateful brats. And if we receive everything we wanted from the Most High, we could end up being the same way. God is not out to tempt us, people. That is not His character. He will only supply us and bless us with what He wants us to be able to handle. Remember, the word says, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed." That's James 1:13-14. God loves us and only wants to do what will benefit us and glorify His name. Proverbs 23 says in verse 4, "Labor not to be rich in the world." Labor not to be rich. Cease from thine own wisdom. Wilt thou set thine eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away as an eagle towards heaven. It comes and goes, people. Gaining worldly prosperity is one of the most modern doctrines of man steered by the devil. Now take, for example, the foolish man that was rich. Many of us might see and be jealous and envious because we don't understand the Most High's way of working. Luke 12, verse 13. "And one of the company said unto him, Master, speak to my brother that he may divide the inheritance with me. And he said unto him, Man, who made me a judge or a divider over you?" Christ is simply rejecting involvement in these worldly matters, like the dividing of worldly inheritance or riches, because His is of a spiritual kingdom, people. Verse 15, "And he said unto them, Take heed and beware of covetousness. For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possess." And what he's expressing to them and to us is to look at the spiritual and avoid the greedy desire to get, which usually leads to other men's hurt, because our life is not preserved by worldly things we possess. It is preserved by God and the spiritual things. Verse 16, "And he spake a parable unto them, saying, The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, What shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits." This covetous man was selfishly thinking of himself in his own mind. And he says this, continues on in verse 18. "And he said, This I will do. I will pull down my barns and build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, Soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry." See, another individual hoarding the blessings allowed by God, building up their treasures on earth. Instead of taking the abundance and sharing with his fellow man, which was part of his responsibility. He said, no, I'm going to build bigger barns and put more and more in there just for me. And verse 20 says, but God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? Because of his covetousness, he has fallen into judgment with God and will pay with death. We have to be very careful, people. Job 21:13 says, they spend their days in wealth and in a moment down to the grave. Just collecting up, hoarding up, getting richer and richer, billions and billions. And then the next thing you know, they drop dead. They didn't do what God wanted them and his will was to do with all these riches. And finally, verse 21 says this, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. So we need to seek to be rich in the Most High and forget about wanting what others have or being jealous of what others have because we think we deserve it over them, and work on preparing our treasures in heaven. Work on our spiritual self, people. Forget the worldly. Let the Most High provide for all your needs, because the more he blesses you with, the more of a responsibility you have to do what is right with it. And remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.